everybody. It's Jeff. Welcome to Guided Listening this week. So I want to talk about the song Maiden Voyage off the Herbie Hancock album Maiden Voyage. So this is one of the most classic albums, one of the most important songs for us to talk about, but there's a particular reason I want to talk about it. The band on the album, Herbie Hancock, Freddie Hubbard on trumpet, George Coleman on tenor saxophone, Tony Williams on the drums, Ron Carter on bass. It was essentially Miles's group at the time, Miles Davis's group, with Freddie Hubbard in it. So here's the thing, the sax player, George Coleman. We're gonna be working with George Coleman at the Jazz Wire Winter Summit, which is coming up January 27th through 29, 2023. So if you're watching this in real time, it's gonna be coming up in a couple months. So the Winter Summit is an online workshop. We have people from all over the world that attend. It's 3 days long. We have an amazing faculty, including Paul Bolenback on guitar. I'm teaching at it, but we have super special guests. We have George Coleman. So I can't believe I'm going to be talking to George Coleman online, right? And asking him questions about this song. I want to know how he was thinking about this song. I want to know how Herbie presented this in the studio. George Coleman, I mean, what a legend. We have Buster Williams on the bass. We have Tia Fuller, a modern legend, someone who's playing with Beyonce and playing with everybody else out there involved in movies and everything else. So we have some amazing, super special guests. I would love for you to attend. There's only 21 people that we have spots for. We keep it small. We keep it really tight so people have an opportunity to ask a lot of questions. And we do a ton of playing together. It's for all instruments. And, you know, I know we might all be a little bit tired with online this, online that. We've done thousands of hours of this online teaching in real time, and it works like crazy. So I hope we'll have you with us. So getting back to this tune, this is a really important modal song. And modal music, it sounds like maybe that might be a little complicated, but really it's one tonality that lasts a long time, one idea that lasts for a long time. In most show tunes and most, you know, Jerome Kern tunes and Charlie Parker songs and whatever else, the chords are changing every measure, sometimes twice a measure. Sometimes the key changes in two or three measures, two or three beats. Here we have one tonality for a long time, in this case, four measures at a time. So this is a really great, important standard tune. Lots of times, at least back in the day, you know, like talking like an old dude back in the 70s, 80s, when I was starting to learn improvisation, people would use this as an easy way to get started because the chords don't go very fast. Here's the thing. This is one of the hardest songs to sound good on, especially when you're a novice. So we sort of know these days when we're teaching that modal music is not really the best place to start somebody. That's not where the history of music started, right? It's better to sort of go with the development of things. So, so this is an important one. So an incredible band. It's mind-blowing to think that Herbie Hancock was 25. I think he was 24, actually, not quite 25, when this was recorded, a young man. And we know he was a prodigy and he did a lot of big things in his pre-teen years, you know, and all the way through. But wow, to hear these young men playing this music and they're inventing it as they go, right? Because they didn't have a lot. They were forging new territory. So that's another thing. These weren't just young lions that did a great job of copying who came before. No, nobody came before. Yeah, people came before, but you get my point, right? Like these were voices and they were so young. It's kind of mind-blowing to me and makes me feel like a bit of a slug. But, you know, we'll get into therapy for Jeff next time. So let's listen to the tune. One thing I want to point out right at the beginning is there's this recurring rhythm that happens all the way through. Bop, ba, 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 da, da. So the piano, the bass, the comping, there's this underlying current of this recurring two-measure rhythm that goes all the way through the tune. That's not very jazz-like. Usually the comping guy gets to comp. Usually the bass player's walking, making up their own line. This is preset, predetermined, so that's very different. And I think that's one of the things that made this song maybe accessible and made it as popular as it was. Another interesting thing from the drums, this song has its own ride pattern that Tony Williams starts with. Every drummer you've heard on every song ever is just sort of making up their ride pattern around the basic cymbal pattern of dang, 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 dang. They're doing, you know, versions of a ride cymbal pattern. Here, it's a very specific pattern that he embellishes around. But dun dun da 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 dang da 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 dang da da dang. So it has to do with the bass line, but it's also filling and moving ahead at times and pulling back. So it's fascinating that the rhythm section is playing really entirely different than the last 10,000 jazz albums made before this tune. It's interesting to check out. Let's jump into it. Herbie Hancock, Maiden Voyage. And this is the intro. There's our rhythm. And repeat it. Here's the song. And you can hear that rhythm, that undercurrent. And how sparse the melody is. There's almost nothing there. Two notes, boo boo boo, two pitches. But the form is a standard form. We played one A section, we just finished the second. Here's the bridge, the different part. And George Coleman starts playing a harmony part. We kind of jump to the comping rhythm. And now we relax back to the last A. Isn't that cool how they build up in the bridge and bring it back? That's different than a lot of the jazz playing that preceded this. Those dynamics, right? And that's the song. First solo, here we go, George Coleman. And we hear Tony Williams on the drums, Ron Carter still staying with that bass line. Herbie's moving around a bit, but he's still addressing that rhythm. And we would call this, I think, impressionistic music. Modal jazz has a strong connection to impressionism in painting and classical music. Monet, Debussy, modal jazz. So we're hearing bebop lines, bebop scale stuff. So definitely George Coleman brings in his bebop stuff, but he also started nice and sparse, right? His mood was different than a bebop solo to begin with. One chorus solo. Here's Freddie. Listen to the drumming behind him. Tony Williams is sort of soloing as much as Freddie is in a way, right? But that pulse is still there. So even with all of the embellishment going on in the drums, that undercurrent is there. It's so hard to do to serve two masters like that. And by the way, to keep it swinging and feel good. And now, swing, is this swing? That's a great question. It's more of a straight eights feel, right? But it has this lilt to it as well. So Freddie really brought it down there. This is the end of his first chorus. Here's the second chorus. And what a quintessential Freddie Hubbard. Cool, man. Double time and beyond and textures and sounds. That moment Tony just came out of the texture, I mean the song almost stopped there at the end of that A section. These guys were reinventing how a rhythm section plays. And Freddie's playing these flurries of notes. Now, this is a lot like what John Coltrane was doing in 1965, these flurries, right? These impressions of the sound. This is the last eight of the solo. And of course, bringing it down, right? We can hear that. Beautiful melodies that Freddie plays mixed in with all that. Cool way to end the solo. He brings it down, then does this huge energetic fanfare, and then he's out. And listen to how Tony is changing the texture. Tang, 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 tang. So now he's playing all eight note drops out, practically. He was really building. He stops playing. Isn't that wild? When we're used to hearing Jimmy Cobb or Philly Joe swing and swing and swing it, how mind-blowingly different this is, and how well done it is. It feels like, you know, Tony is a wave that's coming in and going out and coming in when he's playing. And sometimes it's with the soloist, sometimes it's not with the soloist. He's doing his own things. And maybe the soloist is sort of responding to this conversation they're having with Tony specifically. Listen to the bass. Still that same rhythm, right? Very much the same rhythm. And listen to Herbie's lines. Da, da, da. Done. His solo lines are based on the rhythm of the song. He's not just going wild. George Coleman went a little wild. Freddie sure went a little wild. And of course, here Herbie goes, you know, away from that, but how he's so aware of that recurring rhythm. And again, how hard that is to do, I know as a player, to keep that rhythm in mind, to not let it box you in, but to not forget about it. That amazing middle space, so hard to do. Melody up. So see if you can keep that rhythm going in your mind. Ba, 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 boom, da, ba, 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 ba. Just two measures over and over again, but the chords change, but the rhythm stays the same. And that great shift from the end of the bridge back to the last A section. So, we're four from the end of the song. Three. So how do we end the tune? How do you think it ends? Is it going to be a short? Well, that wouldn't make sense, would it? We have this, you know, luxurious flow, this repetition. We've had this going on for 7 or 8 minutes now. So it would be weird to just stop the tune. So what does happen? So did you get the sense that the musicians started playing softer there and that they just played soft, 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 soft until they weren't playing anymore? No. So I could tell that was a board fade. They kept playing, and essentially the volume knob in the studio, the faders, they brought it down. So the guys kept playing, but in your headphones in the studio, it's getting softer, softer until it's off. So now no signal is going to the tape, but the guys are still playing. Okay, we can stop you guys. Now we're out. So that was a board fade, and it definitely feels different than hearing the trumpet getting softer, softer, softer until it's whispering. I wasn't hearing that. I was hearing the trumpet speaking, 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 but we brought the volume down. Yeah. It's like, you know, turning the TV down in the middle of an actor saying a line. They're not talking softer. You're bringing the volume down. Cool. All right. What a masterpiece. And, I recently read that Herbie considers that of the, I don't know how many hundred songs he's probably written, his favorite song that he wrote. And yes, it's an incredible mood. The album, Maiden Voyage was, you know, had to do with the sea, and, you know, each of the, I think, five pieces were sort of programmatic. Little One, Eye of the Hurricane, Dolphin Dance, I'm forgetting one of them. But you know, kind of had to do with the sea and that recurring motion. And you know, I've no idea if Tony was thinking about this, but it feels his playing sometimes, the way he comes back to nothing, the way the ocean just stops moving. And then here comes a big wave. His playing is like that. And not just on this song, but it just, you know, kind of reminded me, given the programmatic nature of this album, which was another thing that was fairly new to jazz. Sure, Duke Ellington had done the Far East Suite. You know, it wasn't unheard of to have a theme for an album, but that was kind of different and new. So yeah, this is a masterclass. It's some of the best playing of this style with some of the greatest musicians of the 60s, for sure. And, you know, many people talk about this Miles's great quintet with Wayne Shorter replacing George Coleman, but with Wayne Shorter, with Tony, with Ron, with Herbie being, you know, the way they played together, what they developed, really everybody since is still sort of riding on their shoulders. So fascinating tune, modal tune. The idea that the bass did not walk ever in 8 minutes, the idea that the comping was really somewhat predetermined, the idea that there was literally a drum part that then Tony would really get away from, but never, you know, but not so far. So this is such a big deal for people to listen to, for how to keep elements of a song in your playing, in your comping, in your drumming, in your bass line. When to leave it, how much to leave it. That's always a fascinating thing, because I play some drums, I play bass, I play piano, but I play more drums and bass, you know, sort of in a teaching setting. But that's always the question of, I got a written bass line, should I leave it now that we're soloing, or should I stay with it, or, you know, what do we do? So we listen to the greats like Ron Carter to see how they develop a bass line or not. Okay, so I'm fascinated. Again, I really hope you're going to join us for the Jazz Wire Winter Summit. I've got questions I want to ask George Coleman, who's now 87 years old. And I was just talking to my friend Jeff Coffin the other day, who saw him in New York. He said George sounded incredible and sounded more contemporary than all the young guys he was playing with. I believe it. So I want to ask George, does he remember, did Herbie talk to Tony about how he wanted the drums to be, or did he just hire the right guy and turn him loose? Like how much direction was there? Hey, Ron, stay with the bass line. Don't walk. We're not going to swing on this. I'd love to know his memories on it. And, you know, this was a little bit different music, and, you know, what George's thoughts were, you know, when this was put in front of him. So there's all sorts of amazing questions. I would love to hear your questions for George Coleman and Buster and Tia Fuller and everybody else. So this is the place to sign up, jazzwiresummit.com. And I will see you next week. I hope you enjoyed this. And let me know songs or artists that you may be interested in doing a guided listening on. And, you know, this is one I've heard hundreds and hundreds of times. I know this one well, but it's kind of fun for me to do a guided listening on something I've maybe never heard or heard one time. That's also interesting to get some first reactions. So I'd love to hear what you would like to hear. Thank you for leaving some comments on YouTube or inside Facebook. I'll see you next time.